Hey, brothers and sisters. This is Brother Patrick. I want to take communion with you. Let's take communion. I'll give you, pause the video and get yourself ready. I want to take communion with you on this video, then I want to come back and talk about communion more. Got some unleavened bread. It's like a matzo cracker. You can use any kind of bread of what you've got, but if you get a chance next time you go to the grocery store, try to get you some unleavened bread. If you look, most grocery stores, they have a, you know, an international section. Look there, you can even get you some of that kosher grape juice. I think it's Kadim. You'll see it there, and then they also have the matzo. It's like a cracker. If you go around looking around too, some of like in the, if they don't have that, even like the, if you look, you have to look at the label, like the, well, they have the Mexican flatbread, you know, kind of a thing. You look, see, there's no yeast in there. If there's no yeast in there, then it's fine. That's what you're looking for. You don't have to have that though. That's just taking it a little bit more to the next level of saying that, you know, Jesus said, beware the leaven of the Pharisees. And of course, in the Passover, you know, leaven is symbolic of sin. You know, it's a symbolism that we're doing, brothers and sisters. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. Hallelujah, Father. You reign forevermore. Hallelujah, Lord. We came to worship you. Hallelujah. Let's worship him. Jesus is the Lord. Hallelujah, Lord Jesus. Most High God, mighty in battle, is our Lord and our God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus is Lord. Hallelujah. Bless his holy name. He reigns forevermore. Hallelujah. He reigns forevermore. Hallelujah, Father. We worship you. We worship you. You know, a lot of times, you know, I was just thinking about, you know, making the video just boom, doing straight, doing communion. And lots of people want to do that. You know, I was just thinking about it. Look, the point of communion is not to get your ticket stamped, ticket punched. It's not a ceremony in that way. You know, it's a matter of, it's worship. It's a part of worshiping God. And Jesus said, you know, and the Lord's giving me the verse right now from John chapter 4, when Jesus talked to the woman at the well, who's really symbolic of the Gentiles, the Samaritan woman, he said, you know, God doesn't want you to worship him, you know, in the temple in Jerusalem anymore, on that mountain, or even the mountain you guys are trying to copy here in Samaria, because she'd ask him about that. But God is a spirit, and he wishes all to worship him. The time is coming, and the time is now, Jesus said. Now, when he desires all people to worship him in spirit and in truth, brothers and sisters. That's what it's about. Taking communion is an act of worship. Hallelujah. Let's worship him. That's what I've been saying. That's what I keep talking about when I keep mentioning about people running to and fro. They treat God just like he's their meal ticket or their plane ticket to the rapture. And then even being healed, people focus only on being healed instead of the healer. They focus on salvation instead of the Savior, the Redeemer. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. I came to worship the Lord God Almighty. Hallelujah. 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 Let's worship the Lord. Hallelujah. Let's worship him. I worship you, Almighty God, there is none like you. I worship you, O Prince of Peace. That is what I long to do, and I give you praise. Yes, Lord. For you are my righteousness. Hallelujah. And I worship you, O King of Kings. Yes, Lord. There is none like you. Hallelujah. Worship him. Tell him there's none like you. Hallelujah. Tell him. Tell him. Speak it from your heart, because Jesus said, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. That's why they asked you, said, oh, about, you know, ceremonial things, brothers and sisters. That's the theme from the Lord in this video, ceremonial things. They asked Jesus, these people, you know, the Pharisees, they wash their hands, and, you know, you and your disciples don't wash your hands. You know, and then Jesus explained it to them, and then Jesus said, you know, what goes into your mouth, it goes through you and comes out. You know, but it's not so what goes into your mouth that makes you clean, but what comes out of your mouth. For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. Out of your mouth comes vile things. Vile, wicked things. Hallelujah. Your testimony. Brothers and sisters, you know, that's the thing about it. When I do ministry, you know, and then the Lord uses me in the prophetic. And those of you who watch my videos, like words of wisdom and words of knowledge and prophetic things like that. You know, it's coming straight from the Spirit. So, you know, I can get it, you know, as I've made those videos, 20-some videos of words for those who ask, without hearing anything from people. That's a supernatural thing. Okay, but what in the natural, without hearing anything from the Lord, as a pastor, if you listen when you talk to people, and I talk to people all the time, and people are like, you know, they'll tell you something like, oh, I'm really walking with the Lord. And then the next out of their next breath, you know, they start speaking doubt and unbelief. You know, like I say, do you believe the Lord heals you? Yes, I believe I'm healed. And then the next sentence, they'll say something like, well, one of these days, you know, if the Lord's will to heal me, you know, maybe, you know, I know I'll be healthy when I get to heaven. Things like that that people say. Brothers and sisters, so see, then I would say to them something like, well, you don't have faith to be healed. And then they'll say, what do you mean I don't have faith? I said I believe. But what you just spoke out of the abundance of your heart, your mouth speaks. You just spoke that. Well, maybe, I'm not sure. You know, I'm hoping and praying instead of believing and confessing. Now, there are times when the Lord will give somebody a word like he told Paul. My grace is sufficient for thee. That's one person. The Lord said, my grace is sufficient for thee. You read that context. Those old denominational people love to quote that because they try to justify why they have a form of godliness, but deny the power thereof. They want to justify why there's no miracles, no power of God moving in their church. So they say, oh, yeah, well, the Lord said to Paul, you know, he would not remove the thorn in Paul's flesh because my grace is sufficient for thee. One time. But my Bible says Jesus went around about healing all who were sick of diverse diseases. All who were sick. The people that came to him, he healed them. So that's what the Bible says. And that word, salvation, redemption, healing, it's all one thing, brothers and sisters. And that's why I was going to just do the straight communion and make a separate video, but the Lord's telling me to do it all at one time. So here we go. The bread represents the body. Jesus said, this is my body that's broken for you. What does our Bible say? By his stripes we are healed. I want to tell you this, brothers and sisters, because you know the Lord always uses me to talk about this duality stuff. So here's the duality, at least. There's always at least duality. Maybe there's 10 different meanings, 10 different things, which there are. There's an infinite meaning to the things that the Lord says sometimes, and all things, I guess. But anyhow, when we take the communion, we are acting out, brothers and sisters. Not only is, you know, there is part of it that is a ceremony. On the superficial level, it is a ceremony in the fact that this is acting out the Lord's body being broken. People keep wanting to celebrate the Passover. We are in the New Testament. The Passover was a shadow of our Passover lamb. The Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the Lord. That's Yeshua HaMashiach. Not focusing on the fact that the Lord let the angel of death pass over the Israelites. Now that's great to show God's how God interacts with man and how he dealt with those wicked people and he brought judgment and all that. It's a type of the tribulation too, how the Lord will deal with them and how he'll deal with Israel. There are people who have a problem with rightly dividing the word who will tell you that, oh, Israel is a type of the church. Israel wasn't removed from Egypt. They were hidden in the land of Goshen. They were in the midst of Egypt during the plagues. Even though the plagues didn't touch them, they were in the midst. So they're a type of the church. And there is no rapture. Wrong, wrong, wrong. Israel is a type of Israel. So Israel will be kept from the second half, the great tribulation, in Petra. In Bozrah, the Bible calls it Bozrah. Mount Seir, the land of Edom, the Edomites' land there, the land of Esau, the brother of Jacob, a.k.a. Israel, whose name was changed to Israel. He who wrestles with God and man and overcomes, which the nation of Israel has wrestled with God and man and will overcome. And I made videos about that. They wrestle with God through idolatry, through not obeying the law. They wrestle with God of accepting Jesus as the Messiah. And then they wrestle with man throughout their history. And they're still wrestling with the whole world. And they're still wrestling with God about who's the Messiah. But God already spoke that name, a prophetic name. God calls things that are not as if they are. He said thousands of years ago, he gave them that name. He gave the man, Jacob, instead of heel grabber or supplanter, because he supplanted his older brother through cunning trickery two times, he would become someone who would wrestle with God and man and overcome. The Jacob, the man, did and became Israel, and then the nation will do also the same thing. Anyway, brothers and sisters, this is the body, represents the body of Christ. When we do this, not only are we doing it in remembrance of the Lord, but we're acting out prophetically on earth. As God said, you know, the Lord Jesus said in the Lord's Prayer, let thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So when we do this, we're symbolically showing what Christ did, what God does for us individually, what he did for the world, that the body of Jesus Christ was broken for us, that by his stripes we were healed. Just as the fruit of the grape, which I'm using grape juice, because Jesus said, I will not drink any more of the fruit of the vine until I drink it with you in my Father's kingdom. I'm not going to drink any wine unless the Lord gives it to me in heaven. Alcohol containing wine. Some people use that. That's what they were using in the Bible. They claim, you know, it's like a watered down wine, even though it did have alcohol in it, but a lower amount, you know, maybe 1 or 2% or whatever to keep it preserved. That's what they say. Whatever. Don't major in the minors. Who cares? Let's move on. Anyway, brothers and sisters, when we drink this, it represents the blood of Christ that was shed for us. Let's pray, brothers and sisters, and let's partake. As I said, you can pause this and get a hold. Use a cracker, whatever you've got. Use a piece of bread if that's what you've got, and any kind of grape juice. If you have no grape juice and you want to do it right now, just use a little water or something, because we're doing this, you know, the Lord knows you're doing it by faith, and the next time try to get you some grape juice and bread without yeast in it. Any kind. Like I said, look at the Mexican section. They have those flat breads, the flour tortillas. I think there's none in there. Could use that, and that's kind of like the stuff they were making in those days anyway. Oh, this is like a matzo. Anyway, brothers and sisters, let's pray. Hallelujah. As your word says, Lord, on the night that you were betrayed, the Last Supper, Lord Jesus, you took bread there at that meal that you had, the Passover meal. And you said, take and eat. This is my body that is broken for you. You broke that bread. So we always break it. Symbolic of the Lord's body broken for us. Father, right now we receive the healing, deliverance, the power of your broken body and what it did for us. Lord Jesus, we do this in remembrance of what you did for us. And Lord, we know, Lord, that by faith, by your stripes, we are healed. We partake now in the name of Jesus. And I asked you, brothers and sisters, right now, which I should have already said, we need to just, you know, be calling upon the name of the Lord and thanking him and asking him to forgive us of all of our sins. Paul told us when we partake of the communion unworthily, we're bringing a curse on ourselves. He tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 11 that we have to, you know, pray and repent before we take it. All these once saved, always saved people and people living in sin and taking the communion lightly, don't do it. It's a warning. God have mercy on you. Repent right now. Let's repent. Father, forgive us of our sins in Jesus' name. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Some people repent all the time. Some people don't repent enough. And some people, you know, keep repeating and repenting of something we already repented of. You know, the Bible says if we confess our sins, he is just and faithful to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. 1 John 1:9. We thank you, Lord. Now, if you need to stop and continue to repent, go ahead. Hallelujah. All right, brothers and sisters, this represents his blood. Then the Lord took the cup and he said, here, drink. This is my blood of the New Testament. Remember that. All these people trying to put you under the law and the Judaizers and telling you you must be circumcised and what you eat this and you can't eat that, touch this and touch not that. As the Bible clearly settles in the New Testament, it's a new covenant. That's why it's called the New Testament. It's a new, God made a new deal, a new covenant with people. It's a new beginning and a new covenant. Hallelujah. Acts chapter 15, we see what the requirements are for Gentile Christians. Praise God. It's not the topic of this video. Father, right now, we take this cup of grapes, fruit of the grapes, that represents your blood, Lord Jesus. We thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah, Father. Father, we receive the washing of our spirits, that it be, even though it be red like crimson, it should be white as snow by your blood, Lord Jesus. How is it that red blood can make us white in our spirit? Only by the power of Yeshua HaMashiach. We take and drink in remembrance of you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now I ask you just to spend time praising the Lord, repenting, worshiping the Lord. This is the point of communion. To commune, to fellowship at the Lord's table. The love feast, as it's called. Also, it's a love feast. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Father, we thank you in the name of Jesus, Lord God. Lord, I just ask you to have mercy, Lord. Have mercy, Lord. There are so many religious people. Brothers and sisters, I just want to say this. There are so many religious people who are not saved, and they're so upset when I keep praising the Lord. That's a lot of times, you know, as a matter of fact, I'm thinking of a sister that told me her husband will not go to any, you know, evangelical or Pentecostal church, you know, because, and I know lots of people like this, they get upset when people are praising the Lord. They get upset when things are get out of order, out of ceremonial order. They don't want to hear people. I had someone comment on my video the other day. Your video, stop saying hallelujah. It's getting on my nerves. It's annoying me. When hallelujah is the Hebrew word for praise Yahweh. Brothers and sisters, the people that are annoyed by hearing the Lord's name are not saved. You know, it's some kind of a spirit that's getting them annoyed about it. Brothers and sisters, let's pray for them. You know, I'm not on here to condemn anybody, but how can someone get saved if they don't know, you know, they don't hear that, hey, what you're doing is anti-Christian, anti-Christ. They need to hear that. If they're ignorant of that, how can they ever repent if they're not informed? And that's what preaching is. Preaching is not entertaining people, and that's what I've tried to do, brothers and sisters, to be faithful to that. Preaching is not about entertaining people or making people happy, even though Christians, of course, when Christians hear even the most hardcore, you know, hardcore fire and brimstone, they're still rejoicing. But those messages are to proclaim truth, and to those who need to be convicted will be convicted. Those who need to get mad will get mad. Those who will get glad will get glad, as the truth of God has its impact by the Spirit and the Word into the heart of who the hearer. And that's what it's all about, brothers and sisters. That's what it's all about. You've come to a channel where, of course, I'm not perfect. I'm not God. I'm not perfect. But, the there's a famine in the land for truth and the Word. There's lots of people making videos for entertainment value and sensationalism and sometimes clowning around whatever they're doing. But by the grace of God, may God have mercy on me and give me the wisdom and the guidance and the humility to always speak truth in love. And be hardcore. You know, I had just this week, I had to confront my relatives with truth. I had to get loud with them. They tried to, tried to use, their age over me, and the fact that, you know, that they're my relatives, that they should have some kind of a authority over me. And that's even when you're dealing with your relatives, like your parents, aunt and uncles, grandparents, whatever you're talking about. In the natural. Our parents and grandparents or whatever, they have some, you know, they have influence and authority over us in the natural, brothers and sisters. But if you're a Christian and they are not, and even more so if you're a pastor and they're not even a Christian, you have spiritual authority, brothers and sisters. You have to take authority over people. You have to stand your ground. You have to stand your ground in Christ. You got to stand on the rock, and you got to, if you have to get in their face, whatever the Lord leads you to do, be firm, because you've got to speak truth. They have to have heard the truth. So when they stand before the Lord, those words are a witness against them. The Lord has a huge giant hard drive up there, a computer that cannot be swiped and wiped clean. You know, that it's beyond the reach of Hillary Clinton or anybody to try to wipe the memory of God clean. The only thing that removes, we're just doing a communion. See, the Lord's bringing this message together. I had no idea what I'm going to say. I never do. And it's just perfect. Thank you, Lord. The only thing that wipes the memory banks of God's kingdom is the blood of Yeshua. Praise God, brothers and sisters. That's the whole point. When I was having to stand my ground with my own relatives who tried to pull rank on me in the flesh, I said, there's one difference between me and you. There's more than one difference, but the one thing that's the difference between heaven and hell, it's the blood, the Al-Kadema, or whatever they call it in Aramaic or Hebrew. The blood of Yeshua makes me clean. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If we confess our sins, 1 John 1:9, He is just and faithful to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. Praise God, brothers and sisters. Praise God. I'll be back later with another video. God bless.